Hey there, welcome to Sketchbook Club. Today I want to talk about an artist who's probably, might be the most important artist to inspire me personally, even though you may never really know that from looking at anything that I've ever made. But Robert Crumb is somebody who has played a part in my sort of creative life for a long, long time, since I was maybe 15 years old. When I was in high school, the sort of coolest art kid in my school was Eric Drucker. And Eric Drucker, he was the first person who ever told me about David Bowie. And he was the first person to ever tell me about underground comics. And this is in the mid 70s. And underground comics were an art form that had just begun, really, in the 4 or 5 years before then, I would say, early 70s, late 60s, maybe, kind of grown out of the hippie counterculture movement. The idea that you could use the art of comics to talk about drugs and sex and politics and to critique culture. It wasn't just about laughing, jokes, superheroes. It could be about real life. And the dean, that's what they always used to call him, the dean of underground comics was Robert Crumb. Even though he didn't really fit into any of the sort of stereotypes of hippies and freaks, he always looked like a sort of a salesman from the 1930s with a little pencil line mustache and his big horn rimmed glasses, and he would wear suits and fedoras and stuff like that. But he was probably the best at drawing of anybody in the underground comic world. And he also told the most personal and shocking stories in a way. He was a real student of the comic form, and he was a compulsive drawer and always had been. And Eric Drucker had a big shelf above his bed of comics, each of which was in a plastic envelope, plastic sleeve, protected, which had seemed like a very weird thing to me initially. Like, really? Like, you'd keep comics, like precious objects, sealed from the elements? But, for him, they were precious objects. And, he was smart. I don't know if he still has them, but if he does, they're probably worth huge amounts of money now. Eric, he taught me about the language that Crumb used, because Crumb always had strange kinds of words that he would use that sort of grew out of old songs and old slang and things like that. It was just his own universe that he had created. And so it was really comics, the most accessible art form, particularly when you're a kid, turned into something that was exciting and forbidden. Theoretically, you had to be 21 to buy an underground comic, although we always got around it. We used to go to Bleecker Street Comics, which I think is still there, and there were a few other comic stores, and you could go in, you could buy these comic books. And the stories were, in retrospect, looking at them as a grown-up in the 21st century, a lot of them were sexist, violent, racist in a way. I mean, he played a lot with racial stereotypes, the way that black people have been presented in America. But certainly his treatment of women was, he revered women on one level, but he also was abusive to them. And I think that I hesitate in talking about R. Crumb to wholeheartedly recommend him, because, I know that a lot of his attitudes are kind of repulsive. I hope that you we'll take that with a grain of salt, can accept that. I think, like a lot of artists, he has a dark side, and he does some things that may not be correct. So, but nonetheless, he's been very influential to me, not in how I view women and members of other races, but how I look at art and how I look at how drawing can be a way of talking about your life, talking about the world around you, and using your imagination to reflect your inner reality and to bring it out. So another person who was an important mentor to me, besides R. Crumb and Eric Drucker, was Dan Price, who I've talked about before here. And at one point, Dan said to me, have you ever seen the sketchbooks of Art Crumb? And I said, I had no idea. No, I don't know anything about them. And he said, in our library, they have copies of the published sketchbooks. And I'm going to send you copies. And what he did is he sent me some Xerox copies. He sent me some Xerox copies. These are them. As you can see, they're much-thumbed, dog-eared, bulldog-clipped, volumes 1, 2, and 3. Now, the thing about these books is, these sketchbooks, this is beginning in the early 60s. And as we look at them, you'll see that they are, that they're familiar to people who record their lives in sketchbooks, right? I mean, he's drawing just the stuff around him. He's doing some comics, but a lot of, like, this is all just different kinds of weird musical instruments, you know, stuff around him. So he's drawing all kinds of things that were just, you know, regular stuff, people, so on. Over time, you know, they became a bit more fanciful, but still, studying cars. And you can see, I mean, look at the way this guy draws, right? Pretty amazing. You know, pretty cool stuff. So anyway, so I was like, wow, these books are really cool. And Dan said to me, yes, the sketchbooks are really cool, but they're pretty expensive. They were, I think, $20 a copy. So this, I do actually have a few of the actual volumes. I eventually went out and bought my own copy, so I didn't have to just have the Xerox ones, and also I could see what the color was like. But, you know, so there's volume 2, there's volume 3, and there's volume 5. But there's, they go on and on. And this volume 5 is only up to late 67 to early 68. So this is an entire book of his sketchbooks. All kinds of stuff. Now, there was a movie, a really fantastic movie called Crumb. It's a, that is a documentary film about Crumb made over the course of a fairly short amount of period of time. I think it was a few months. And it was a time in which Crumb was moving to France from California, moving to south of France. And the reason that he was moving to south of France was because he had sold a case, a trunk full of his sketchbook, all of his sketchbooks he had sold to a collector, and he had gotten a big chunk of money, and as a result he was able to move to France. And that's what this book is about, this movie is about him and this process of him leaving and starting a new life, but also about his family, which is the most insane. You've just got to see this film. It's weird, it's crazy, it's amazing. Anyway, so these sketchbooks, I think, kind of came out of that process of him selling stuff. Now, fortunately, Toshin, which is a fantastic publisher, I mean, they do really high quality stuff, they brought out a series of these books recently, and they took the individual, fairly expensive books, and they combined them. So this is volume one now, is 1964 to 68. So this is like the best time. And this is, this book has, again, all of these fantastic drawings. You know, drawings of, this is his first marriage, his son being born, and so forth. But then just all kinds of stuff. I mean, the guy drew all the time. And you can see, this is 4 years worth of sketchbooks, just on and on and on, and comics as well. So many great, great, great drawings. He drew from observation, but he also was able to draw anything from inside of his brain too. Lettering, everything, amazing. So, this book, I forget what the price of it is. It's, considering how expensive those books were, it's not that much money. I think it was like maybe $30 for this enormous book that is, what, how many pages is it? 500 pages of this sketchbook. So incredibly well worth it. There's also, I have this incredible thing, which is, this is made in Germany. It's a German edition of this book. Comes in a slipcase with a little sort of explanation in German about it. But then look at this book, it's beautiful. You see how it's like an old record book, and it's beautifully prepared, and it's all this, these are the drawings from the 70s, mid-70s. Look at the quality of his penmanship. I mean, it's just an incredible artist. And these are, again, his personal sketchbooks, you know. These are not necessarily made for public consumption, although he ended up selling them. But definitely when he was drawing them just for himself. A lot of it is like him, you know, exercising his sexual fantasies and his commentary about society, but then also just drawings from his life, you know. And all kinds of stuff is in here. It's a beautiful book, and this is a beautiful version of it, of his stuff. So I just want to show you a couple of other things of Crumb's just to get you in the mood. This is a book called Waiting for Food. He made a couple of them. And these are restaurant placemat drawings. So he would go to this restaurant in California, and he would just draw. He lists here the three restaurants that he would go to, and he would just draw on the placemats while he was there. You know, so these are drawings of people at the restaurant, food, just stuff in his mind, overheard conversations, all kinds of things. And, you know, essentially, these are disposable drawings. He was just doodling while he sat there. And, you know, it was just free, rambling stuff straight from his head. And he planned to leave them behind. I think they were collected by the people at the restaurant, and eventually he got them and had them made into this book. So that's another kind of really great document. This is a book also that is from the early 60s, and this is when he became a sketchbook reportage artist. Because originally Crumb didn't really know what he was going to do with himself, and he went to work for Harvey Kurtzman, who was the cartoon editor for Playboy at the time, and he was starting this magazine. And so he sent Crumb to do reportage on Harlem. And he went and he just drew life in Harlem, stories, the people around them. This is Harlem in 1964. You know, this idea of this, here he is, drawings of gang members. Look at these gang guys in like suits and ties. And then he went to Bulgaria. So this is, again, behind the Iron Curtain, 1964. You know, a country that was so depressed and run down. And Crumb did this. I love these. The style, the way he always does these vertical lines. It's just, go on and on about him. So this is a book of just his experiences there and his stories of what it was like to be in these two communities. You know, and then, of course, there's endless collections of these comics, as you can see. You know, this is just a compendium of just Weirdo, which was one of many comics that he published, Zap. There were other ones too, Bijou Funnies. But so these are all his. But again, just as a student of art, just the quality of his lines, his drawings, lettering, and just the sheer volume of stuff that he made. This is a whole section of covers that he did, designed. I find it very inspiring. You know, the funny thing is that Crumb, the most successful book that he did, the book that sold the most, is a book that when he first did it, I said, seriously, are you kidding? And it's this book, The Book of Genesis. He literally took the entire Book of Genesis in the Bible, and that's what this is. It's just a comic, you know, starting at the very beginning. God created the heaven and the earth. And it goes through every single thing. And Crumb, you know, doesn't hold back. There's violence. There's Cain killing Abel. And there's sex, because the Bible is full of sex. And particularly the book of Genesis. Here's the story of Noah's Ark. So, in a way, you know, this is sort of the holy book. And he spent a lot of time and effort in making this whole story of the Bible. And, you know, it's literally every story, every chapter, every person. Here's all the sons of the sons of the sons of all the prophets and so forth in the Bible, all in here. And then, for those of you who, you know, if the Bible's not your cup of tea, and if some of the more sexually explicit stuff isn't your cup of tea either, I would recommend this book, The Sweeter Side of Art Crumb. And what you can see here is really his personal drawings, drawings of his family. Sorry about this light, by the way. It's just this afternoon sun coming into my kitchen. Yeah, so here's a nice brush painting. Look at this. Look at the quality of these drawings. Spectacular. I mean, he draws with a pen and ink as well as anybody alive. Amazing, right? There's a lot of drawings from old photos like this. Crumb is a huge fan of essentially country music from the 30s, old 78 records, and that's a lot of what he personally has been in a band that he plays that kind of music. He collects these old records and he's made books about them and drawings of great musicians, these still lifes. He's probably just done doodlings. He's sitting in a pizzeria. This is probably, you know, that's his brother. Drawings from old photos, drawings from his obsessive about girls he went to high school with. Lots of drawings of them. I think he likes these kind of more athletic girls. His beautiful still life of... So, The Sweeter Side, if you're interested in that. Now, finally, I want to show you the equivalent of Eric Drucker's comics that he would keep in envelopes, and this is my own version of that. Let me just zoom in here to show you. So this is in 2003. I got this postcard from Art Crumb. Thanks for sending a copy of your book, Everyday Matters. I just finished reading it and looking at it. As soon as I finish writing this postcard, I'm going to start a drawing in my sketchbook. I'm inspired by your words about what drawing from life does for you. It has done that for me also, but I was such an unbalanced, frightened of everything person in my youth that for me drawing was also both a defense, a way of hiding from the world, and at the same time a way of communicating, connecting with the world. Another big difference is that I was driven by ambition to make something of my artistic skills, to make a name, to be a paid professional. And I succeeded in this. The sad irony is that the success, the attention, has made me acutely self-conscious about drawing at all. It's almost painful for me now, drawing. I have lost that fervor, that deep personal communion that I used to get from it. Maybe not entirely. I have to fight my way back to it if I want to continue to draw. Ironic, huh? So it goes. I've had my share of tragedy in my life, but nothing quite so close to home as what happened to you. But overall, I was probably a more alienated and depressed person than you, so it all equals out. Still, as my Jewish wife often says, look out for the evil eye at all times. Keep drawing. Then he has a little piece of editorial to give me, commenting on the cover of Everyday Matters, which he says, terrible cover design, too cluttered, bad lettering, should have hand-lettered it, used one good drawing. Just my professional opinion. And actually, when I did the paperback version of Everyday Matters, I took his advice and I did. I changed it. So that's my holy relic, my postcard from Art Crumb. So, A, look at the work of Art Crumb. B, buy yourself one of these sketchbooks. They will provide so much inspiration for you. You will never regret owning one of these books. Any one of his sets of drawings, just study the way that he cross-hatches, the way that he adds personality and character, the way that he tells stories that are deeply personal, where he puts it all out on the page. He says things are shocking because they're living inside of him and he's letting it all out in his art and in his sketchbooks. There's so many ways in which Crumb can inspire you. And, you know, I think it's just having some person like this in your life, a creative person like this who has inspired you through the course of your life, is really interesting and important. I mean, I go back and I look at Crumb, and I have done for over 40 years now, you know, and he's still alive. He lives in the south of France still. He is, you know, they're publishing lots and lots of his books, and fortunately for him, because honestly, he it's not that he labored in obscurity, but he was certainly ripped off by a lot of people and didn't live a comfortable life. And now, you know, thanks to all these publications he has, Toshin in particular, doing a beautiful job of reproducing them. So there's definitely ways to own these books and their keepsakes. So Sketchbook Club is something that means a lot to me because I get to share all the artists and books that have kind of contributed to my personal creative life. But Art Crumb, I think, has been the one who I've waited. This is what, episode 20 or something? I've waited a long time to talk about Crumb just because I kept going out and buying more and more books of his, thinking like, well, you know, do I have enough to really explain? And I realize I haven't gone in detail through page by page of any of these books just because there's so many of them. So maybe I haven't done a great job of presenting him. See, I'm feeling a little insecure about it now, because again, he is such a sort of an artistic hero to me, but also a controversial figure, as I think I've hopefully made clear as well. But an important one. So anyway, it's been fun talking to you about Crumb. I think I'm going to go and watch the documentary again. I own 2 DVD copies of it, and I really like to look at it periodically. He's kind of a crazy person. I think in a lot of ways, you know, he has 2 brothers who kind of went off the deep end, and I think he has always said that drawing and cross-hatching in particular kept him sane, spending huge amounts of time just focusing there and putting all of the thoughts in his mind out on paper and actually making a living out of it. So, word to the wise, if you're feeling a bit nutty, get out your sketchbook and do what Crumb do. Do some drawing. Nice to see you again, and I look forward to next time sharing with you a book or so, or an artist from my collection. Bye-bye.
I start with this one because it's probably the thing that I'm most well known for in the world. I don't know why it caught the popular imagination, caused me nothing but headaches for 10 years after I drew it.
There's this legend that I keep hearing all the time. Somebody told me he used to live with the Grateful Dead. I never had anything to do with those guys. I hated that music. I went to a couple of those rock concerts and just fell asleep. It's kind of completely boring. It's psychedelic music.
When I was about 5 or 6, I was sexually attracted to Bugs Bunny, and I cut out this Bugs Bunny off the cover of a comic book and carried it around with me.
I think you were more inhibited as a child than I was, even sexually. I think you were more afraid of women than I was as a young person.
This one here, Naomi Wilson, is this cross-eyed farm girl that wore homemade clothes to school. I secretly had a crush on her, was very sexually attracted to her. Of course, you never dare admit it openly that you like this funky girl that had BO and hairy legs. This Jean Strelley, I liked her too. She was also considered a dork.
I was the most unpopular kid in the high school. People were always picking on me and beating me up, and the girls wouldn't have anything to do with me. They treated me like I was the scum of the earth. Some people like me and some don't.
Now I don't even leave the house anymore. He always got in trouble whenever he went out. So
no, he didn't.
Can you give me one good reason for leaving the house?
It's my image celebrating Valentine's Day. February 13th, 1962. Girls are just utterly out of my reach. They won't even let me draw them. Yeah, all that changed after I got famous.
You know, Robert's not too oriented towards normal sex, so there wasn't much in the way of normal sex in our relationship, but lots of piggyback rides and wrestling around, and like to sit on my shoe a lot.
I'm a really big fan of yours. I'm wondering if there's any chance I can get an autograph from you.
I don't think so. No, I was very fond of you. Ouch.
No.
that period where you tried giving us all enemas? That didn't work out.
No, I never gave any enemas. Were you
somebody